because of the long hiatus in psychedelic research, there's a lot we don't know about how they can be used to help people. And at this point, now that we're actually turning around and looking at these substances with a fresh eye, I think that there's a lot of benefit that we're finding, whether it be producing mystical experiences, helping ease end-of-life anxiety for people who are near death, or in the treatment of addiction or depression. There's a lot of potential uses that have really yet to be explored in a scientific way, and so we think it's worth looking at.
If there's any realm that we should really be the master of that domain, it should be the exploration of our own individual consciousness.
This is my first psychedelic science conference. It's been quite an experience. There's a ton of people here. I love that it's, you know, university professors and you know, people that I might have met at Burning Man all in the same place at the same time.
It's my first time at MAPS conference. I'm really interested in psychedelic research.
There's a shared desire to do something positive, more than just canned food dropped off. People are doing something positive with maybe their whole life, or they're fiercely dedicated to something that would be accentuated by being here and meeting people and learning more. So I feel there's a lot of smiles and a lot of kind, intelligent people here.
Have just been really impressed and really struck by the depth and breadth of research that is taking place.
They really are committed to the scientific method and legitimate research. And they are very careful, and a lot of the leading researchers are very cautious about who they select for to be research subjects, and I think that's really important.
This conference is bigger than any other conference we've ever organized. I think having the community together really was the reason why the conference was such a success.
It's always great to see an evolution and an increase in attendance, seeing the certain tracks change and grow.
I think what's been more developed here is the opportunities for people to speak with each other. We've set up more spaces, we've set up more time for that. You know, right now in the marketplace area, it's going until 2 in the morning or something, so there's lots of time for people to talk to each other.
There's a lot of really amazing things happening out there.
I'm particularly interested in mental health and addictions, and there's a lot of information here about that.
And Bill Wilson, who's the founder of Alcoholics Anonymous, who did a lot of research and personal experimentation with LSD in the 1950s, long after he sobered up, thinking that LSD could be used to help alcoholics have the spiritual experience that's so important in the 12-step program.
Right now, I am helping to complete a pilot study, which is for helping people quit smoking cigarettes using psilocybin and some combination of cognitive behavioral therapy.
I feel the Hopkins approach is successful as a result of combining a caring team of researchers with a comprehensive support system in conjunction with the psilocybin sessions. None of the three components would be as effective if used individually. Truths are simplified, issues become transparent and manageable, life's values become more self-evident. Your individual reality is expanded.
As of right now, our results for the smoking study seem to show that psilocybin could be very useful in helping people quit smoking, and so why would that not be something to investigate?
These aren't just recreational tools, but these are therapeutic tools and spiritual tools that have been used for thousands of years.
Traditional ayahuasca ceremony offers an opportunity for rapid limbic revision, resulting in profound healing, likely in part through epigenetic revision in the limbic system and related structures and beyond.
I think that psychedelics are one way of achieving a state of mind that is achievable through other paths. But those other paths aren't necessarily an option in our society, especially for people who are severely addicted or severely mentally ill. It's not realistic to ask them to sit and meditate for as long as they need to meditate for to get to that place. Psychedelics provide a realistic option for helping people reach those places to allow that shift in perspective that can help them, help me reevaluate my life and move forward.
Mainstream medicine is one particular perspective that has a lot to offer, both in the treatment of chronic and acute illness, but which also seriously fails to understand human beings, to know how to encourage healing inside a human being. We separate the mind from the body. We're not very good at dealing with the healing of chronic conditions at all. And if we don't know how to cut it out, burn it, or poison it, we don't know what to do with it. The issue of alternative medicine is one of language. The first question we've asked is, alternative to what? Because when you see alternative medicine or complementary medicine, we're making the assumption that mainstream medicine is somehow the valid or accepted way to do it, and everything else is an alternative to it. Actually, it's much more complicated than that.
My passion is really kind of reframing the conversation around psychedelics and trying to encourage people, especially young people, to be able to speak articulately and compellingly about what's going on with psychedelics.
The Psychedelic Society of San Francisco is an organization that we started a little over a year and a half ago. Actually, at the MAPS conference was our first meeting, and there were just 30 people there, and now we're up to almost 4,000 people across our various social networks. And we host lectures, film screenings, discussions to bring together people to talk about psychedelics in a more educational context.
And SSDP is an international network of students who are fighting back against the counterproductive war on drugs. And SSDP essentially empowers youth members to get involved within the political environment to advocate for sensible alternatives to drug prohibition. In a time of an alcohol or drug overdose emergency, students are hesitating to call the police or paramedics out of fear of their friend getting in trouble or arrested, maybe kicked out of school, or themselves as well. So we advocate for Good Samaritan, also known as medical amnesty policies, that remove that hesitation factor by removing the academic punishments associated with making that call.
Right now, I'm working on a project to find an ethnobotanist or an anthropologist that's familiar with psychedelic science and present what's happening at the Psychedelic Science Conference to the world, really let people that have never heard of ayahuasca before into this fascinating world of culture, different tribal rituals, the science, the fMRI, all of that.
The legitimate research of psychedelics is important, and there's always an increasing sense that we will pop through and maybe do it, maybe do something right as a culture.
Art is really the only way to encapsulate and to share the experience of visionary realms that we have available. You know, we can't take cameras and recording devices into our visions, and so we are kind of at the mercy of the visionary artists or artists that have chosen this particular strange creative career path.
Some glimpse in a spiritual truth and make it accessible for everyone, despite their language or background. With enough legalized psychedelic use, enough open-mindedness on the psychological front, that we could actually break through to a permanent, peaceful human solution. At least this is keeping us afloat. These studies keep us afloat, and keeping it on a legitimate scientific discussion table is so important, or Marlboro will buy everything and everything else will be destroyed. We have to have that edge.
The founding of MAPS for me was kind of astonishing, and so in order to do that, you kind of have to recognize that the system isn't entirely corrupt, and that there are ways in which, by being part of the system, that it actually has some value. You know, I wasn't sure if it ever worked. You know, I just knew that it was something worth struggling for. And the fact that we would be having meetings at the Pentagon, that we would be already working with veterans, that we would have LSD studies and MDMA studies and ibogaine studies and ayahuasca studies and published magazines and have conferences with so many people. So I never thought the challenges would be so great, but at the same time, the tools are increasing.
In terms of discussing publicly the potential benefits of psychoactive substances, psychedelic substances, we mustn't be evangelists. We mustn't be trying to convince anybody. It's not a cause. It's simply a great potential modality for helping a whole lot of people. So we need to present the evidence for it seriously and humbly. And we have to expect that some people will be drawn to that, some people will not be. And we have to be clear that it isn't the panacea, that we're not offering here the solution to the problems of the world or the healing of every ill person on the planet. All we're saying is, here's a modality that has a lot of research behind it, There's a lot of human experience behind it that has proved to be transformationally healing for many people. Why exclude it from the conversation?